Folks, do you know what I just did? I just guaranteed that I'm not going to have biscuits for the next 10 years. Yeah, I saw, you know what the look on her face said? No. Just wait till I get you home. Good morning. How in the world are you doing? We're a little thin this morning, but that's okay. I want people to take every opportunity to admire God's wonder. And that's what we have people doing this morning, because I'm going to crack down later about church attendance, and we're going to build it up. This church has come so far. Folks, if you only knew, I told my wife right after I became the pastor here, I said, Meryl, in 35 years of ministry, I've never seen a church so broken. And I blame it on the United Methodist Conference. When they closed this church during COVID, they almost killed this church. And so we're coming back. We're a comeback church. You're going to hear me talk about that, preach it. We are, because we're doing God's work. So it is so good to see you this morning. And I say good morning to you on this 19th Sunday after Pentecost in the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Let me cover some announcements with you. The first one, which is not in your bulletin, is that the last Sunday of this month, we are going to have a blessing of the animal service in this sanctuary. So you can bring your pets. Now, I need to know right now, does anybody have a pet snake? Nina feels the same way I feel about that. I have blessed snakes before, but I really would almost turn myself inside out rather than have to do that. But you can bring fish, you can bring dogs and cats and hamsters and skunks if they're fixed. You can bring your pets. And we're going to make it a worship service. It's on Sunday morning, and it's in the Methodist Book of Worship. So this is not something I'm crazy making up, you know. So we're going to do that the last Sunday of this month during our regular worship hour. Please mark your calendar, and there's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex about this. I'm going to be teaching a journey through the Bible. In seminary, we called it a survey of the Bible, where we will take a cursory examination of each book of the Bible, and you'll have a sheet that you can take home for future reference, and hopefully you're going to learn something during this. Renee, crocheting's still going well, but you've still got room for people who want to join. I'm tempted to take up crocheting. For Idell Christian Ministries, they need what? They need canned soup and crackers. Yes, they do. So I lift that up to you. Pumpkin picking day. When's it going to be? It's going to be the 15th. It's going to be at Maureen and James's house, and it's going to be at 4:30. So please take note of that. I understand that Trunk or Treat's going to be inside the church. Starts at 6 o'clock. It's going to be on October 31st. It'll run until 7:30. And we need candy. Quit eating it all yourself. Share some with the church. We need candy. And there's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex for that. Now, Allison is looking for help. She's looking for someone to take over the Feeding the Future weekly food bags, boy, that's a mouthful, for Scott School, okay? And the information's in your bulletin. If you feel led to help her out in this, please let her know. I mentioned sign-up sheets. There are a number of sign-up sheets out there in the narthex. Please take a moment and check all that out in that beautiful display. Now, does anyone else have anything else for the good of this congregation and the glorification of our Lord? Are you going to say something to me?
He goes to Scott.
He goes to Scott. Well, good. Oh! You know what? That's a future leader of this church. I got to be good to him. One day he'll be able to fire me. Does anybody have anything else as we move along? If not, then would you please stand and turn, come out of those chairs, welcome each other. Especially welcome Jolene. She's back with us after being ill. So, I should say sick, not ill. I don't think she has an ill bone in her body.
Ben had his hand up.
Long as they don't run circles, because then I get dizzy. I'm waiting on Melissa. We're going to start in just a second. I'm waiting on somebody. Don't worry, I can trim the sermon. Make it shorter if I have to. There is a call to worship. I hope it's going to jump up there on that screen. And by the way, before we do this, I learned yesterday that our problem with the ProPresenter logo has been fixed. Amen. Mr. Chris Stikeleather, you need to stand up, sir. Stand up. Well, at least he got a little taller. He sat up straighter. He went through old emails and found the registration number that we needed to plug in, and that's how he fixed it. Praise God. So we're so thankful for him and all the good work that he does. All right, let's go to this call to worship. Welcome to God's house, a place of faith. Here you will find nourishment and hope. Here you will find rest from your struggles. Lord, prepare our hearts to receive your words that we may leave this holy house of faith and return to our homes, encouraged and challenged to be your people. Amen. Let's have some music.
There's got to be more than going back and forth. Do it right, do it wrong. We were taught that it's who we are. Come on, get by. You along with everybody. Thinking there's worth in what you do. Feel like a hero who takes the stage willingly on the edge of a seat, saying, let me introduce you to Amazing Grace. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has paid. The cross has paid.
The cross has paid you
for all. That's exactly what he did. No matter the cost, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has paid. The cross has paid.
The cross has paid.
No matter the hurt or how deep the wound is, no matter the No matter the faults, no matter the bruises. matter what they say or what you think you are, the day you call His name, He made you flawless.
Next song is I Have Decided to Follow Jesus.
Let you do the affirmation of faith sitting down this morning. I forgot one announcement. There will be a leadership council meeting immediately following this service. And Alan, it's going to be right here, right? It's going to be right here. Okay, having said that. For our affirmation of faith for the month of October, we're using the Korean Creed. It's not difficult. It was established by a bishop of the United Methodist Church. And if you look on the back page of your bulletin, there is a little blurb that describes it and tells you about it. It's a very good creed, and I like it a lot. So now let's look and see what it says to us. And read it in unison with me. We believe in the one God, Creator and sustainer of all things, Father of nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the Savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God contained in the Old and New Testaments as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the Church, those who are united in the living Lord for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God as the divine will realized in human society and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen. And thank you for contributing to that. If the ushers will come forward at this time, we will render up our gifts, our offerings, and our tithes to Almighty God. Father, as Christians, we have placed ourselves into your hands. And now, as your children, we place these gifts into your hands that they might be used to further your kingdom and that they might be used to bring others to know of the life-changing love of Jesus Christ. And we offer them up in His name. Amen. Well, I had something I was going to say to you before children's church, and you know where it went? If you find it, grab it for me, would you? Let the children, are we having children's church this morning? Children's time? You know what I'm trying to say, Cindy.
Man, isn't this a good-looking group of young men and women up here this morning? I'm so glad to see each and every one of y'all. So, this morning, we're going to talk about love. So, love is what love does, right? So, you know, I have a dog, and his name is Junior. He's a golden retriever. And yesterday, I went down to a craft fair at South Ireland. I took him with me. And you know what he did? He went through that place, and every little boy or girl he saw, he had to go up to them and just give them love. They petted on him, and he would just wiggle all over. He's a loving dog, and he shows how he loves people. And you know what? That is exactly what Jesus tells us we need to do. Jesus loves us, and we have His love in our heart, right? So we need to turn around and show that love to other people, right? So how do you think we could show love to other people? Somebody give me an idea.
Help.
Help. That is perfect. That is a great way to show love. Come here.
A hug.
Oh, great idea. A hug is a great idea. Anybody else? Okay, you think a little more. You know, helping and hugging, that is wonderful. Being nice, right? Saying kind words to somebody. What if you go in, like if you would come into church and there'd be one person sitting by themselves, would you go sit with them? Yeah. Or invite them to come and sit with your group of people, right? Yeah. So there's a whole lot of ways. That's what Jesus wants us to do because His love is right here in our hearts, right? And He wants us to show other people how He loves us by us loving them. Now, today, mom and dads, please don't kill me, but grandmas, whatever. You know what one thing I love to eat? Not candy. Peanut butter. I love peanut butter. So I'm going to show y'all how much I love you by sharing peanut butter with you. Do not open it until your folks say you can. Who else loves peanut butter up here? Yeah. You eat peanut butter and jelly? Me too. Did you get one, honey? Okay. Yeah, come here. I got peanut butter for you. You don't like peanut butter? Oh, come on. You like peanut butter? Here, you go take that to your mommy and daddy. You want one? All right, did everybody get peanut butter? So know that when you eat peanut butter, you know how much I love you because I shared my peanut butter with you. Let's say a prayer real quick. Oh, you're welcome. God, We know you love us. You show us that every day. And Lord, let us go out and show our love through easy ways, through a hug, through helping, through peanut butter, through a smile. Lord, help us always to show people that we are yours and we love you and you love them. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
But peanut butter. I can't handle peanut butter. As we come to our time in our worship service for Operation Guardian Angel, let me first relate to you that yesterday I had an opportunity at the Fun Fest, and by the way, I just remembered what I was going to say. Thank you for everybody who came out and helped with that effort. It was a great turnout, and everybody seemed to have a good time. I know I did. But anyhow, as I started to say, I had an opportunity to talk to the two deputies, Deputy Jamie and Deputy Mark, and we have prayed for both of them during Operation Guardian Angel. And I'm going to tell you what, you should have seen their faces whenever I had a chance to meet them and relate to them how we're praying for each of the deputies and the detectives and all of that. And you know, I just wish you could have witnessed the expression on their faces to know that when they're in harm's way, that a church has prayed for each of them by name. So let's do that now. Let's go to Operation Guardian Angel. This Lord's Day, we pray for Deputy David, Detective Justin, Deputy Michael, Detective Alyssa, Deputy Devin, Detective Cheryl, Deputy Jackson, Detective Nathan, Deputy Alicia, Detective Cody, Deputy Weston, Detective Karen, Deputy Jonah, and Detective Craig, would you respond? Lord, these men and women keep us safe. Now keep them safe. In Jesus' name, amen. And when we go to our time of prayer, would you please lift them up as a group and pray for them? I'll tell you, the deputies and the detectives were throwing me off the rails there, but we will pray for them because they do such a valuable service. They provide such a valuable service to us. Speaking of prayer, it's time to go to prayers, and I have just about been bursting with what I'm about to say to you. I had been asked not to divulge this, not to reveal this, but this morning, Doris Ann Talbert gave me permission to let you know that she has breast cancer. And to let you know that it was on Tuesday, right, Doris Ann? You had a full body scan done to determine if that cancer had spread to anywhere else. It has not. Praise God, hallelujah. It has not. God is good. All the time? You better believe it. So as we go to prayer, let us remember some other folks. Jolene is back with us this morning after a stay in the hospital. We're so thankful. I don't have to come looking for you now. Do you know how good you look? You look so very good. We want to remember Linda Peek. We want to remember Helen Combs. I've been asked that we pray for Tommy Fox, who is suffering from cancer. Helen Combs, Ruby Beatty, Nancy Harris, LaVon Gallagher, your boss, Mike Lewis. And we want to remember our military. Berg's son, Michael. My son, Gunnery Sergeant Adam Talbert. I think that's Captain. Is that what that is, Norman CPT? I'm not sure either. Ben, Lance Corporal Evan Yandel, E5, that would make him probably a sergeant, Kaylee, and E6 would make him Keith a staff sergeant, and Gunnery Sergeant Casey, I guess that's Sin. We want to pray for those folks too. They have taken the oath, and they are willing to go in harm's way so that we might come and worship here without fear of persecution. There are no soldiers with rifles in the parking lot telling us how we can or cannot worship, and it's due to these folks in our military. So I ask that you lift them up in prayer. Is there anyone else that we want to lift up in prayer this morning?
June McCoy.
Anyone else? The people who are traveling. They ought to be here. No, I'm kidding. I'm just kidding. We want to pray travel mercies on everybody that is out there taking advantage of this beautiful weather, and the leaves are starting to turn. A lot of people are going to be going to the mountains, and we want to pray for them. We also want to welcome this morning and pray for our folks who are worshiping with us online. No matter what their needs are, God knows their needs, and so we want to lift them up in prayer this morning too. Anybody else? Then the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, on this beautiful October Sabbath, we are called to remember that that's what Sabbath means. It is a day of rest. But it's also a day where we can come and have our spiritual batteries recharged, that we can come and be with brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that no matter what we're facing, no matter what we're going through, no matter what's happening to us, that we know that we can turn to you, and that you'll not only be with us, but that you will strengthen us and give us the wherewithal to come through whatever set of circumstances we may be facing. And Lord God Almighty, we are thankful. We, a thankful people, have assembled this morning in your house. This is our priority, to worship you, to show you that we love you, and to listen to you as your Holy Spirit speaks to our hearts. Father, we ask that you would grow our faith. I know Jesus said we only need faith the size of a mustard seed. But Lord, sometimes we feel so weak. As we go through life, we age, and things happen to us that we least expect. Our personalities even change. Sometimes, especially this old preacher, we become irritable. But thank the Lord, you have put loved ones around us, and your angels watch over us, as the Bible teaches, and we are thankful. Father, be with us this Lord's day. And as we pray, we ask that you would bring peace to Israel, that you would bring peace to the Middle East, that you would help those people who are just trying to live out their lives, but they're being persecuted. And Father, even though your word tells us there will be wars and rumors of wars, we can still come to you and pray for peace. We do that now. God, hear us now as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught. He said, when you pray, pray like this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. This morning we have a rather unusual scripture lesson. We're actually going to three books. First, we're going to the book of Isaiah. Let's go there now. We're going to Isaiah 43, verses 18 and 19. I'll give you time to get there. There we find these words. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Now next, let's go over to Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. We're going to Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. That's chapter 3, 13 and 14. Philippians is one of the prison letters that Paul wrote while he was in prison in Rome. He writes, "Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." And then, brothers and sisters, finally we hear Jesus speak some words that almost sound blunt. We're going now to the Gospel of St. Luke, as found in Luke chapter 9, verses 57 through 62. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But he replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." And this is what? The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Pray with me. Father, I ask that you would mute me, so that the words that these precious people now hear will be your words and not mine. For I pray it in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. This is a secular holiday that comes at the end of October. Anybody know what it is? Halloween. And if I say the word haunt or haunting, what do you think about? Ghost. Well, this morning I'm going to be talking about haunting, but I'm going to be talking about it in a different context. I'm going to be talking about something that haunts a great many people. But first, let's have a story. There was a family who lived way back in the hills. I mean, way back in a remote area. But they decided to go to the big city for a vacation. And so they went and checked into a grand hotel. And then they left the registration desk. And they headed for the elevators. But they stopped and they stood there looking at those elevators because they had never seen an elevator before and didn't know what it was that an elevator does. They just stood there watching. And about that time, an older lady, gnarled with age, hobbled towards them and got on one of the elevators. And the elevator doors closed. And a few moments later, those same doors opened again, and this time out stepped a stunning, beautiful young woman. And the father was so taken with this young woman that he didn't even turn his head. He just reached behind him and tapped his son on the arm and said, "Quick, boy, go get your mother." What does that story have to do with this morning's message? Not a blessed thing. Not a blessed thing. Actually, as we read, we're looking at five verses that are spread over three books. Two from Isaiah, of course, in the Old Testament. Two from Philippians, of course, in the New Testament. And then, I don't know, how many is left? Three? That we read from St. Luke's Gospel about some things that Jesus had to say. Let's go back and examine each one in a little more detail. What's the message from Isaiah? Do you remember what we read? It speaks of forgetting what's happened in the past. To forget what's happened in past years, to forget what's happened in past days. In other words, what has happened to you in the past? And I want you to stop and think about that in your own lives. What's some things that have happened to you in the past that you have trouble getting off your mind? It just keeps popping back no matter what. You can't seem to get rid of that memory. It's old history, but it is affecting your present. Can you think of some things like that? Well, in this passage from Isaiah, God says he's going to do something brand new. Brand new, not a leftover, brand new. And you might remember that I talked about this particular passage when I preached a sermon around the stroke that I had back in 2012. At that time, when I was laying in the intensive care unit up in Mission Hospital in Asheville, I was wondering. And do you think that I ever dreamt that I would be a pastor again? I couldn't hardly walk. The nurse kept coming in there and putting this arm back in the bed. And it would fall between the railing. And she'd say, "It's done it again." And I'd say, "It's done what again?" She said, "Your arm. It's fallen out of the bed." When I got home from the hospital after being there for a week, I was doing dumb things like putting milk up in the cupboard. It's a wonder I didn't put the dog's food in the fridge. Those were dark days. Dark days, and like I said, on that first dark night after that stroke, do you ever think that I dreamt that I would ever be pastoring a church? And yet, God reminded me that night with this very scripture that he was going to do a new thing. And so I did walk again. I did recover far more than ever expected. I remember when I couldn't go up these steps. I remember the first sermon I preached here, and I had to hold on to something, or I'd fall over. And I was standing right here, and I went like this, and Cindy about fell out of her chair because this thing's on wheels. And she was afraid that I was going to push it too hard, and that table and I were going to go zip. But look, I don't need that railing. Look, God said he was going to do a new thing. And he did. Doris Ann Talbert, God is going to do a new thing in your life. Jolene, I prayed for your knee this morning before the service. God is going to do a new thing in your life. And you folks, if you're not ready for new things breaking out all over, you better be forgetting that way. Because our God is a God of new beginnings. He is a new beginnings. And little did I know that this new thing that this scripture told me about included me becoming the pastor of this church. Huh? I never expected to be in ministry again, at least not as a pastor. And do you think that I ever thought his new thing included Monticello becoming a comeback church? Yeah, we're a little thin this morning. It's autumn. The leaves are turning. It's beautiful out there. The weather is absolutely wonderful. But that's okay. We're a comeback church, and we are coming back. And yes, friends, even back then, God had plans not only for me, not only for this church, but he had plans for you as well. Now let's take a closer look at what Paul said to the church at Philippi. First, we need to remember that this man Paul was also the man Saul. He was the man that violently persecuted Christians. He took part in the stoning of Stephen when Stephen was stoned to death. And yet, on the Damascus Road, we know how God took Saul through a conversion and he became Paul. And Paul could have let these tragedies that he had been a part of hinder him, to rob him of what God wanted him to do. But Paul didn't let these things haunt him. He didn't let them haunt him at all. What things? Well, did you know that Paul was shipwrecked no less than 3 times? Did you know that he was in prison no less than 3 times? Did you know that he was beaten with rods no less than 4 times? Did you know that he was adrift in the sea for an entire day and an entire night? And did you know he was pelted with stones 1 time? And yet, Paul did not let any of these things trip him up. Instead, he challenged himself, just as he challenges all Christians, to keep moving forward on our Christian walk of faith. Why? Because when we allow ourselves to dwell on things out of our past, things like bad family relationships, things like bad experiences at work, things like bad periods of health, things like bad marriages, we get burdened down by these things. When Paul said he was forgetting those things which are behind, he was teaching us not to let anything stunt our spiritual growth. You know, some people come to church and they say, "Well, I've done it. I've done all I needed to do for this week." Wrong. The Bible teaches that we are to continue to grow in our faith, that we're Christians under construction. Do you realize that? That you're a Christian under construction? And that you're growing more every day. And so letting things creep at us out of our past that can stunt our spiritual growth is not what we want to do. For Paul, spiritual growth was a constant priority in his life. Tell me something. Let's modernize it a little bit. Do you know of anyone who has suffered a bad marriage? If you do, please just lift a hand. I'm not going to ask who. Do you know of anybody who suffered a bad marriage? Well, have you noticed what a lot of these folks do? All they ever seem to be able to do is talk about how bad their ex-husband or ex-wife was. They can't let go of the past. They can't shut the door to the past. And forgetting what is behind is Paul's way of saying, don't let anything behind you block what is ahead of you. Now finally, in our scripture lessons for today, we come to a remark that Jesus made. One day as Jesus and the disciples were walking along the road, A man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied that discipleship has a cost. It's not free. It's kind of like freedom. Discipleship has a cost. When he said, the foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. Evidently, he saw that that man would make a good disciple. But the man replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. What did Jesus say to him? Jesus said, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Now to us, brothers and sisters, that reply is almost certain to seem harsh or even mean. Let the dead bury their own dead. No, Jesus didn't mean it like that. He didn't mean it like that. And if we examine it, we see what is at the center of what a Christian attitude should be. If you're a Christian, what must come first in your life before all else? Melissa, say it again. God. What must come first before all else? Your loyalty and devotion to Christ Jesus. Sadly enough, there are folks that haven't learned that yet. And truly, sadly, and it breaks this pastor's heart, but if I said otherwise, I wouldn't be telling the truth. There are some folks in this church that haven't learned that yet. You know, I invite people all the time to come to church here. And I hear excuses all the time. Folks, salvation is only possible through an active relationship with Christ. That's what it means to believe on Him. To have an active relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's nothing to be taken lightly. I can assure you that it will not be taken lightly on the day of judgment. In St. Luke's gospel, Jesus says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. Hard words? No. Jesus is not saying actually to hate, because we're taught what? There's a commandment that says we are to honor our fathers and mothers. And we're taught to love one another. But following Christ is not one or the other. It's all or nothing. Either you do or you don't. It's that simple. Lastly, another person says, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. But Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to a plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Again, is Jesus being mean or harsh? Well, let me see if I can explain it this way. I'm old enough to be able to remember my grandfather plowing with a mule. And I can still remember how straight his rows were. Why were they so straight? Because he never looked back. He kept his eye fixed on an object ahead. Maybe it was a fence post. Maybe it was a tree. Had he looked back while that mule and that plow was going forward, those rows would have been as crooked as a hound dog's back leg. But he kept his eye on what was ahead. Jesus is saying that a disciple must look ahead, because the kingdom of God is before us. It's not behind us. It's our eventual destination. Do you realize that? You're not going to die and just leave this world and just wander around in cosmic space. No, Jesus assures us that we're headed for a particular place, and He's prepared it for us. And I preached to you on that before. You know, one man learned an extremely hard lesson about looking back. The year was 1954. It happened in Vancouver, British Columbia. You may have heard the phrase, the miracle mile. It's where two runners in the same race run a mile in less than 4 minutes. Those two runners were John Landy and Roger Bannister. And Landy had led all the way, almost from the very beginning of the race. And as they were approaching the finish line, he looked behind him to see where Bannister was. And Bannister passed him on the other side and won the race. A hard lesson to learn about looking back. Folks, if you have anything in your life that keeps creeping up, give it to God. You don't need to carry that bag of rocks around. Bad marriage, bad relationship, bad experience at work, whatever it might be, don't let it keep creeping into your life and dragging you down. Because you're headed for glory. You're headed for glory. And so this morning, I want to conclude by saying thanks be to God for His faith in us as we live out our faith in Him. And may the peace of Jesus Christ find you wherever you are. Amen and amen. As you go about your everyday duties, I want to ask a favor. I want you to reach out to somebody. Just reach out to them. Don't preach to them. You can say, Nina, how are you today? Michael, how you doing, bud? Alan, you're looking well. But not as well as that lovely wife standing behind you. Reach out to someone. Greet them with a smile. You know what you do when you do that? You shove ugly things in their past further back so that they're not being troubled with them. Now go, my friends. Go. And may the peace of God go with you. Amen.